Okay, so I'll be doing Google Analytics and WordPress, although it should be really titled Google Tag Manager and WordPress. Although I don't think, how many of you all know, okay, I guess it's more of like familiarity kind of thing. How many of you all know Google Analytics? Google Tag Manager? Yeah, precisely. So that's why it's supposed to be more on Google Tag Manager, on how to use Google Tag Manager to do Google Analytics and other stuff as well. So a bit more about me, just now John has already introduced me on what I do at work, but a bit of myself is that I'm a WordPress enthusiast. I do WordPress development and maintenance work, server administration work on the side as well. I also went through Google Squared Data program. I'm one of the initial batch for the program. So technically, I'm supposed to know Google Analytics and Google Tag Manager well. But my day job, I'm there for about a year plus already, so most of my knowledge is now on Adobe Analytics and Adobe Dynamic Tag Manager, which is their own offerings. So my day job, what I do is, like what I say, it's an analytics consultancy. We do services like planning or for your analytics, how to properly implement your analytics on the website or on your assets. We do the implementation as well. That's where I come in. I help clients to do implementation, give them advice on the technical side of the implementation. Reporting is basically what you see on your Google Analytics dashboard, and a bit more as well. We do customized reports. We also train staff of our client for our clients. We do consulting as well. Sometimes our clients will ask us, "Hey, based on this data, what kind of actionable insights that we can get from there? What kind of possible things we can do?" The solutions we offer are basically Adobe Analytics, Adobe Tag Manager, Adobe Target. Adobe Target is personalization solution where we can offer A/B testing or personalized experiences, setup, stuff like that. We also do Google Analytics, Google Tag Manager, but only on if our clients insist on doing that because of their legacy issues or of cost issues and stuff like that. We also do Optimizely, which is I would say the more for value for money version of Adobe Analytics. Adobe Target and ObserveProint. ObserveProint is a tool that we use to help with running an audit for web and mobile properties. My role there is a digital analyst, which what I do is implementation. So what is the agenda is that basically I'm just going to run through which analytics platform to choose for yourself or your property, why to use a tag manager and how Google Tag Manager works, how to set up GTM in WordPress and setting up Google Analytics in GTM. We also go in brief on the debugging aids that you can use in order to find out why some things don't work and why some things work too well. And also what are some of the next steps you can consider. So basically, what analytics platform to choose is, it boils down to five key factors. One, the first one is your stakeholders. Who will be the one signing off the platform? That's the key, one of the key stakeholders. Key stakeholders will be, who are the ones using the platform? Are they the marketing person or the business person? What are they aiming to get out from there? We have to ask them all these kind of questions, because different analytics platforms, they honestly have their own strengths and weaknesses. The next one would be the business requirement and goals. You should should support both immediate company requirements, as in your within 1 year, what kind of metrics you want to get out from this analytics platform, and what kind of future goals you want to get out from there. Like, say maybe for now you have a very static website, or say like, hi, I have a new product coming out soon, and in the future it's like, hi, this is my product now, buy my product. So what kind of goals you want to get out from there from now and in the future, and also what kind of access or data we would like to have. Certain analytics platform like Adobe Analytics to give 100% full access to your data, whereas Google Analytics you would have to twist a bit here and there if you are drawing out too much data from them. They will cap your data, they will do some sampling for Google Analytics, but it can be done, it's just more of a hassle. And also how you want the reporting to be done. You want it to be done within a dashboard itself, like Google Analytics dashboard itself. It might be limiting, or you might want to use a third party tool like a third party business intelligence tool, like Tableau software or Quick software, right? So you have to consider these factors. Well, how much access can you get from there? The next thing will be data governance. So when we talk about data governance, it's not basically saying like, hey, this is my data, don't touch it. It's more of like, how do you want to get the data out right from scratch until the end? How you want to see the data to be put into the database, how you want the data to come out. It's basically an overall strategy of maintain processes that enables proper handling of data throughout the organization. So sometimes you might have someone new on board and they will place in random values, like maybe inside your home one of the values that you want to track. Like the simplest one would be like your homepage, your page title, and they come up with a random string of text that you do not understand that you will not understand until you dig much further. That will take a lot of time as well. The support and resources that the company, that the platform will provide, is also a key thing. Tech management is also another thing, and usability and security. All these are stuff that all analytics platform providers, they actually provide. It's a matter of how personalized the support you're going to get from them. Like from Google Analytics, if you are on a free plan, you might not get support at all from them. Usually we rely on the community in order to help with certain issues. Whereas for Adobe Analytics or for some other fully paid premium solutions, you get personalized one-to-one support, or you have an entire team to support you when shit hits the fan. Yeah. The next thing to consider will be program integration. Like, what is your existing marketing toolkit, right? So if you're using a very, very tightly integrated toolkit like Adobe Marketing Cloud, which is Adobe Analytics and Adobe Target and Tag Management is a part of, usually we'll just go ahead with the same vendor. But if you're running quite customized toolkit, this concern is not there. You might want to use Google Analytics with Optimizely or some other third-party tools. So all these are stuff you have to consider. Next thing will be the cost. How much you want to pay out now or in the future. So I can tell you up front that for Google Premium, or now they call it Google 360, right? It's about 150,000, but the free is free, but you won't get as much feature as the 360. Google Adobe Analytics is about minimally 10k 20k per month. So if you are in the enterprise level, going to enterprise level, that's the cost you're going to settle. But if all of you all here are SMEs or small companies, small websites, right, just go with Google Analytics. Yeah. So why a tech manager? I'll first talk about tags first, right? Tags are basically snippets of codes placed either in the header or footer sometimes can be very dynamically placed, like maybe you click a button, then a tag will appear. They enable third-party tracking, analysis, and reporting. And this includes like Google Analytics, DoubleClick, Adobe Analytics, Optimizely, on some others like Facebook Analytics as well, Facebook Insights, or Facebook Pixels. All these are considered tags. You might not notice them, but for Google, this is an example from Google Analytics. This is just one tag. Imagine if you run a fully, imagine that you're running a website with a lot of marketing campaigns going on with multiple vendors. With multiple vendors, you will have 20, 30 tags on the website itself. I came from a media industry when I was in Google Analytics, Google Square Data Program. So when we open the client side page, you can easily see 20, 30 tags from multiple marketing vendors, remarketing vendors, primary social sites, all these kinds of things all start to come up. And it's actually a hassle if you think of it, if you have to get your IT guy to come down and do the development. So it actually bonds out of increasing need for more agile marketing measurement and tracking ability. So what happens is that before using a tag manager is that when you plan an online media buy, it's basically when you plan an online marketing, you want to buy AdWords or maybe Facebook ads, and then you realize that your website doesn't have the required tracking codes that the vendor needs, right? So you have to ask your IT person, your IT guy or IT team to say, hey, I need this tracking code to be on this web page. And depending on how your IT team is structured, what's the development cycle structure, if they are on an agile basis, it's typically a week, which is fast. But for a lot of companies, especially the SMEs or the bigger companies where your SMEs, they might not have a dedicated resource, so they might engage an outside person or outside agency to do this. It can take a month because it becomes a waterfall kind of implementation. And in bigger companies, like some of my clients right now at work, MNCs, the development will take about 1.5 months, 2 months kind of thing. So imagine 2 months. For these 2 months, you can't do anything. You can't buy your advertising stuff because you have no way to track the effectiveness. So with setting up Google Tag Manager or any other tag managers, what you can do is basically plan your online buys, your online market media buys, and get the required tracking scripts from the vendor. Use the tag manager, place the scripts in the tag manager, and because all this will bypass the normal usual IT development flow, it can be done in a week, typically. So how does Google Tag Manager work? It's from bottom up. Bottom is a data layer. Then we have the variables, triggers, and tags, right? So data layer is basically a piece of JavaScript code. It's usually a JavaScript object or array that exposes the required information for the tag manager to pick up. So it can be it's a JavaScript code, so it can be var data layer equals to post title, and you have the post title, comma, URL, and the URL comes out, and whatever other stuff you want from there. Next is variables. They call that variables inside Google Tag Manager. It's basically a name pair value, which the value is populated during runtime. When I say runtime, it means when Google Manager starts to load on your website. So they draw information from not only a data layer, but from other sources like custom JavaScript. You can run custom JavaScript to manipulate some data out from your web page. Let's say for some reason or another, you do not have the author name inside that data layer, inside a JavaScript code. What you can do is that you do some screen crawling, screen scraping to pick up the author name from the article. Right. The next one would be triggers. Triggers are conditions where text will fire. So triggers is the way that they structure triggers is actually very, very fluid. You can trigger it on page load or on certain events or even on button clicks or on or video plays, stuff like that. And tags are basically your Google Analytics tags or your media tags, right? So for WordPress, there are actually a lot of plugins right now that set up that will allow you, help you set up with our Google Tag Manager relatively ease. So my favorite is actually this Tag Manager, this plugin called Duracell Tommy's Google Tag Manager for WordPress. The main reason why it's my favorite is because it's one of the first plugins that came out. I didn't really explore the other tag managers, management plugins, but it is very flexible in the sense that the data that they'll pull out into the data layer includes post information, the various post information, your title, your author, your when you publish, when you update and stuff like that, everything is there. It even has weather information if you want the weather information to be exposed for certain reasons, like maybe you are offering umbrellas on your website, and if the weather is inclement, you can suddenly comes up with an offer to say that, hey, this is 20% off for umbrella or something like this. Umbrellas on website. Next will be browser information. If you want to discriminate between the different browsers, like you want to give people using Chrome offer A where there's 50% off and people using Safari 40% off. But most of the time, browser information is used to determine what kind of issues that will come up for personalization setup. Because personalization setup, you have to do a lot of browser testing, and sometimes in the rush to implement personalization setup, you might miss out one browser or two during your testing phase, and this kind of information will be useful for debugging. Next one will be media player events. Media player events are basically YouTube plays. When you start, when you stop, how long do you play for, in terms of percentage and stuff like that. Scroll tracking is basically page tracking from the start to the end. How long does a reader reads your article? Did you scroll too fast or did you scroll too slow? Or did you even complete scrolling at all? It also has integration with Contact Form 7 and WooCommerce, which I find pretty cool because it actually saves a lot of work for me when I do implementation. So let me show you the back end. So this is my own site. I use it a lot for playing around with different tools and plugins and what's not. So if you see my setting, I actually have a lot of different stuff going on at the same time. So for Google Tag Manager, that plugin is basically just like that. Tabs that is organized in accordingly to what they are meant for and doing. Okay, even blacklist tags if you want to. Yeah, so you can run a contact form integration. I have a contact form 7, a basic contact me form. So I click that to do the tracking itself. You can even change this if data layer name, but typically we won't advise changing it. You can scroll a lot of stuff and some of the credits. Right. So moving on. Alright, so setting up Google Tag Manager, it's basically You go to Google Tag Manager website, tagmanager.google.com, right? And you set up. After you set up, you come up with a container, and in this container, it has this very nice material design that displays out. The first thing that will catch your eye is create a new tag. Next thing, it's what's the description? Because this is for myself, I lazy put description, but the latest one should be published for production use, stuff like that. Or if you have media tags that's in there, you can say, just added Facebook tags on it. Editing, you have workspaces. I would not, although the feature is there, but I wouldn't encourage using workspace too much because it actually confuses people. Every time you publish the workspace, let's say you use a second workspace, right, to do a lot of tinkering, and when you publish a workspace, the workspace actually disappears. Yeah. And it goes into this semi-merging mode to back into a default workspace, waiting to be merged into there. It's a hassle to deal with. So we do not, I wouldn't recommend using workspace. There's also versionings. So one good thing about the versioning is that you can actually see that right now it's version 5. If let's say my version 5 is screwed up, I can actually roll back to version 4. Right? So if right now in version 5 I have a lot of changes here, but if it screws up, right, I can just do a wholesale rollback because I might not be able to figure out what went wrong. And when I do a rollback, it will be useful so that there is minimal downtime. Yeah, so I can actually change over here. Is it change here? No, change here. Yeah, under actions to set as latest version. Yeah. Okay. Then. Back main. So this is an interface. So tags are basically right now there's only Google Tags, Google Analytics tags, and some other tags that I've set up to do scroll tracking or contact form completion. So these are tags. Triggers are very descriptive, like where you trigger. One thing is that you have to set all pages if you want. Set up all pages to match for all URLs. Otherwise you'll not be able to trigger anything. Yeah, and variables are here where there is a list of like click classes, click elements, all these clicks. I would suggest enabling debug mode so it won't actually affect stuff. What's it called? It won't actually affect your production setup too much. Yeah. Okay, and folders are basically a way to organize your stuff, lah. But I don't do this, that, right? Okay. So, when you set up Google Analytics in GTM, right? So these are some of the pro tips. One is to create two properties, analytics properties in your Google Analytics account. By default, everyone will be usually use like UA-12345-1. But if you're going to do a lot of testing and stuff like that, it's going to pollute your production data, which might not be useful for your analyst. So what I would recommend, what a lot of people recommend, is actually to create two properties. So you have a dash two, where you can use that debug mode to do a simple lookup to find that, it's a debug mode, therefore I will use dash two instead for testing, so that it will not pollute your production data. Okay. Second one is to make heavy use of the data layers and variables for your triggers. And third one is to be aware of what the plugins can offer you when you use WordPress. This in a sense that certain plugins, like especially Contact Form 7, I like that because they have a lot. The author the author had actually exposed a lot of custom events where you can actually use to do analytics tagging, event tagging, in order to find it. So you don't actually need to rework, like say I need to track a submit button in order to get to see, in order to see whether it's a successful submit or not and stuff like that. There's already a custom event there. Basically, it's just CF, WPCF7 successful submit. That's it. Yeah. So be aware of what plugins you use and what can they offer you. Right. Debugging aids. The first, if you're using Google Tag Manager, right, or even Google Analytics, the best one is actually Google Tag Assistant that is created by Google themselves. It's very comprehensive. There's a screenshot of the page, so I can show you on here as well. So let's say on the live side. Right. Right now I'm in preview mode. So in preview mode, it actually pops up with this very nice overlay of saying what tags are there. Right now, there's a Google UA Universal Analytics that's been fired. What variables are there? So it says here, select a data layer message. So you select this message here, and it will show you what kind of information that has been fired and stuff like that. The data layers, right? So these data layers actually shows you what information are there. So let's say now I go to my tag. Okay, let me go to an article. Where is the article? Yes. Okay, this article is long enough to show. Okay, so now there's one more tag that says article loaded. So basically, this will only fire if it's a post. Previously, it's a home page, or if you go to contact me or about page, you will not be able to see this firing. And when I scroll this, you will see articles start reading. And when I scroll all the way to the bottom, right, somewhere here, you will fire an end reading tag. So all these are actually events tags here, and if you go to a real-time view, you can actually see them firing here just now in the last 30 minutes. Yeah, so load, start, and end. Yeah, so all this information you can actually go through your audience acquisition and behavior to slowly look through and do your reporting and stuff like that. Okay, so that is Google Tag Manager, and here as well. Sorry, yeah. Here is very basic, showing you what tags are there from Google. There are also other tags like from ObservePoint. They have their own tag manager. The links are in subsequent slides. I'll put the slides up later so you can see, so you all can reference and read some of the resources that I actually went through to get some of this information up for you all as well. OmniBug, and also do not neglect what is inside the browser, like the JavaScript console or the network console, because all these actually have are actually quite powerful tools to do the debugging. So if I go to inspect and see, right, right now it just says console, but for certain tag manager, or you can actually set customized console.log messages to see whether the tags are firing properly or not. And you go to network, let's say if you do not have ObservePoint, this is an ObservePoint tag, right? So ObservePoint tag actually shows you other things as well, like WordPress stats. The WordPress pixel stats comes out as well. But if you do not have all this and you are using a clean browser, you can actually just search for Google's for the URLs that Google, for the image that Google sends over. So for Google Analytics, it's basically www.google-analytics.com/collect. Yeah, and it so happens that collect is the only this URL only has is when you fire this URL is the only one that has the word collect. So that's why I use collect as the filter. But one thing about network is the network panel is that it's not a very friendly kind of reading. You have to decipher what's DL, what's UL, what's DE, right? They're not going to say this is a page name, this is your language and stuff like that, because this entire string itself is a resource to them. If it's too long, the server will not accept, you'll get truncated. They won't get the necessary information. Yeah, so for this, after a while of debugging and reading through and stuff, documentation and stuff, probably will figure this out easily lah. Okay, yeah, I'm more familiar with it. Yeah, thanks for it. Right, so the next steps, one is to start planning on your analytics setup. Honestly, this should be your first step. Plan for your setup first. Do not implement Google Analytics without knowing what you want to set up. You can do the basic setup of just the on-page load, but if you want to start thinking about like search or contact us, button clicks, all these kind of things, you have to start planning, because events tracking, all this kind of stuff, they are actually very, very resource intensive. So for Google Analytics, what they do is that for the first 10 or 20 events, I can't remember the exact number, they actually just track everything at one shot. But after that, they only will track one event per second, per session. So if you have a lot of events firing, let's say for some unknown reason, you want to track every single second of a person watching a YouTube video on your page, right? After the first 10 seconds, right, you will not be able to see the same kind of flow coming in, and the information will not be actually useful to you. You might be only be interested when you start watching and stop watching. Yeah. So if you don't know how, engage consultants. And also to read up on the analytics, Google Analytics and Google Tag Manager documentation. What I have covered just now, in the short 15-20 minutes, it's just a tip of the iceberg. It's just, I would say it's 1%. The documentation actually offers a lot of stuff. I honestly didn't touch Google Analytics for about a year already, and when I come back and see, I was shocked, because it's the inside there, about 40% of the stuff is foreign to me already. Yeah, so always look at documentation. Yeah, and questions?
Yeah, in terms of plugins, the one that you were talking about was Jurisville Commons Quest for GTA.
Yes.
Monster Insights for Google, that's where you're going to set up the link to Google?
Yeah.
Would you use them both?
No, you use either one of it. The reason being is that GTM will actually have Google Analytics set inside it already. So if you see inside here, right, under text, it's already set up inside here. So if you use any other plugins to, right now it says GA property, but it's actually the tracking code. So if you use any other plugins, right, you're going to have the tracking codes been embedded in the website 2 times or even 3 times, depending on how many plugins you are using. Yeah.
So this is like a script set.
Yes. Yeah. No. Okay, so the beauty of this is that it's supposed to be loading asynchronously away from the main thread. So instead of slowing down, you actually should speed up a website. Like at the start, when I say that I had clients who have like 20, 30 tags firing, they were firing synchronously on the page itself before they move on to the tag management service. Before they move on to the tag manager. So before that, they were like loading easily a minute, 2 minutes. But after taking all these tags out and loading the tags asynchronously, it cuts down to 30 seconds. Because it's not going to block the execution of your JavaScript anymore. Yeah. Sorry?
Which content is downloaded most?
Oh, okay. So for that, you actually can use, you can actually set up a tag to fire on, say maybe your content is purely PDF, right? You can set up a tag to, and or images. You can, let's just use PDF for simplicity. You can set it up to trigger only on links that links to a PDF. And you can use it to fire, say, with information such as which page is it downloading from, what is the link of the file, what's the file name, and what time they fire, stuff like that. Yeah.
Cross-selling and upselling. It's kind of analytical.
Cross-selling and upselling. Honestly, cross-selling and upselling, that one is, I do not.
But is good tag manager enough, or do we need to have Adobe basically
like just a great type? No, okay, so cross-selling and upselling is more on personalization setup and stuff already. You use maybe Adobe Target or Optimizely to do it. Optimizely. Optimizely, I'm not sure. Can actually go and check. It's Optimizely is based on volume. No, you can use analytics to determine whether cross-selling is effective or not. You can use that to determine whether it's effective, but to serve the cross-selling content and stuff like that, you want to do it dynamically, the best way is to go through Optimizely or other personalization tools. So Optimizely, what they offer is experimentation and stuff like that. Basically, trying to see whether certain products will sell more to certain people. Yeah.
So, in the beginning of inside, you said the workflow, right? Goals should be set up. And
yeah.
Can you just go?
So, okay, when I say goals to be set up. Yeah. So, this is more for your analytics. Like, right now, like what I say, right now you have a static page, because or maybe it's for certain constraints, cost constraints or resource constraints, you need to set up a static site to say that, hey, these are my products, but I can't sell it to them right now. But at the same time, you also would like to know maybe like how many people has downloaded the brochure of that product, or how many people has signed up to indicate interest and stuff like that. So this is the immediate goal that you are looking at. But in the future, and it expands to say e-commerce, where you sell a product A or product B or maybe umbrella or shoe or something like that, right? You want to see whether the person has abandoned cart, where is it, at which stage she has abandoned cart, and why is it abandoned cart and there and stuff like that. You can use that tool should optimally be able to do that as well.
Do we have to
Sorry?
We have to analyze patterns. What kind of user is coming and you find umbrellas?
That one, yes, that one is, yeah, is depending on, is really what you really want from the tool.
Tag manager has
it? Tag manager is your way to just implement the tags. If you want to see which user buys what and stuff like that, it's already the data, and that should be in your analytics platform. If you are using Google Analytics, you should draw from Google Analytics. Yeah. Okay.
So do you have a way to recommend a strategy to use Tag Manager and have you SEO improvement?
Tag Manager and SEO improvement.
How do these two then use together to improve my
From SEO, people use Tag Managers? Not really. I don't think so. Do you, Tommy? No, right? Yeah. Even my clients, the bigger clients where they have dedicated SEO teams, they don't use Tag Managers per se. But if you want to start filtering things like site load speed and stuff like that, then Tag Manager it's basically one of the things that they will consider. Yeah, but mainly just to make sure that it serves the content as fast as possible. Yeah.
Does Tag Manager support Facebook Analytics?
You can put in as a third-party tag. Yeah.
So, you heard of Facebook?
Yeah.
So it's, I don't know, to me it's something similar to, Google Tag Manager. Is it something similar?
Yeah, it also fires events. So it's Facebook Analytics, as well. So, like what he said, like he asked me a question about Facebook Analytics. You can use it to go through a Tag Manager.
So there's and to Facebook, right?
Mm-hmm.
You have Facebook, so
yeah.
Buyers, and then you can actually, when you do a Facebook advertisement,
yeah.
You can actually based on the events that you find.
Yeah.
Google Tag Manager work with AdWords so that you can sort of like target users they are actually more towards
firing
ads.
Yeah.
So it works hand in hand.
So Google Tag Manager obviously will have integration with Google AdWords. Yeah, they consider it as first party integration. After all, they are the same company anyway. So as these products offered by the same company. So you can say maybe like let's say you have a brochure downloads, right? And what you might want to fire is a pixel or AdWords or pixel to fire when someone downloads the brochure, so that in the future you can do a remarketing, do a better remarketing. This is what the Google Tag Manager is meant for. Yeah. Yeah.
I would have a quick question. How do you handle spam bots who ping your server constantly and this way they produce false things?
You filter them out.
Yeah, you can filter them, but there are always new coming.
Yeah, it's a never-ending battle.
Can this be automated somehow so you do not constantly have to filter them out?
Right now there's no way to go about doing that except to really filter them. Because what spambots basically do is they basically just take UA dash and just draw a random string and put a dash one in front, or for maybe the more opportunistic 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? And then they'll start spamming that link on their own. Basically, just create a request to be sent to Google Analytics. There's nothing you can do about it except to filter it because it's not under your control. Yeah. So the only way is just to filter them out, and when there are new ones coming out, just keep filtering out. Yeah, I'm sorry to say that, but that is something that people are asking me as well. Right? Yeah. Right. Any questions? No more. Everyone good? Okay. Yeah. So I will upload these slides. Yeah. So the resources links, a lot of links. which goes in depth. Like, what's a Google Tag Manager? There's a YouTube link on that. And yeah, stuff like this. Okay? So that's it from me. And